Designing a Multidimensional Poverty Index, Lesson 4. Entering this lesson, you already understand what multidimensional poverty is. You clearly perceive its connection to international policy agendas, in particular the Sustainable Development Goals, which stress that nobody should be left behind. You're also well equipped with strategies to engage policymakers and set solid foundations for your national MPI. You understand the importance of identifying a political champion in your country, how to reach out to them, as well as to other opinion leaders in academia and civil society. You have to keep in mind that communication is an essential element of the process leading to a sustainable and useful national measure, so it needs to take place from the beginning of the process. From a more technical side, you also understand the fundamental features of the Alkire and Foster method. You understand the normative decisions that it requires for it to be operationalized. You understand the kind of data that it can build upon. You have also gone through some examples of how this method was applied in different countries and in different contexts to build national measures. This lesson has got you a step further in the process of developing a national MPI, by presenting some important technical aspects that you need to take into account. The first technical step is to create a universe of indicators. These are potential indicators that are aligned with policy priorities in your country and that are useful for monitoring progress towards ending poverty and reducing human deprivations as outlined in national programs and development strategies in the short, medium, and long runs. There are different kinds of indicators that you may wish to consider in this universe. It depends on what needs to be measured from a policy perspective. For example, you may wish to include gender disparities by designing one indicator that captures the proportion of men in the household who don't have a certain level of education, and then another indicator capturing the proportion of women who don't have that same level of education. As another example, you may wish to consider housing conditions. It could be the case that you have separate programs to improve roof, floors, and walls, in which case you may consider three separate indicators to measure housing conditions. But it could also be the case that those three elements of a house are combined in a more comprehensive housing program, in which case it would make sense to have a one single combined indicator of housing conditions. A second key element is that once the universe of indicators is set, each one of its elements has to be checked for technical relevance and adequacy. Some indicators, for example, may have too many missing values, in which case they are not useful to truly reflect people's lives. This is a technical deficiency. Another complication may come with the fact that the proportion of applicable population for an indicator may be too low. For example, finding children under the age of 1 to see whether or not they have been vaccinated can be very difficult using survey data. Another issue that one can come across quite regularly is the fact that one indicator may have a very low level of deprivation. This is what happens with illiteracy, for example. This means that it has become a rare event in society. It could be the case that the indicator still has an intrinsic importance to be measured. However, it shouldn't be a part of the MPI because it is no longer useful to track progress. It should be monitored alongside the MPI and not necessarily as a part of it. When assessing the adequacy of an indicator, one has to keep in mind that the purpose of the national MPI is not to summarize information. It is rather to detect overlapping deprivations. For example, we know that deprivations in health and education tend to manifest very frequently, especially in very poor households. This does not mean that one has to get rid of one of the indicators, for the simple reason that they are the object of very different policies to battle them. So there is a policy justification to keep them both in the measure. In fact, the overlapping deprivation of those two indicators actually can be used as a way to measure the intensity of multidimensional poverty. A third key message of the lesson is that once the universe of indicators has been refined, One can then move on to the process of envisioning candidate measures or trial versions of the national NPI. These candidate measures can differ because of mainly three reasons. The first is that they may regroup indicators in different dimensions, or they may define different deprivation cutoffs. For instance, one trial measure may consider sanitation as an indicator of the health dimension alongside nutrition, whereas another one can consider it to be an indicator of the living conditions dimension alongside housing. As another example, two other trial measures may both consider years of schooling as an indicator of the education dimension, but one of them associates deprivation to having less than 6 years of schooling, whereas the other one considers 8 years of schooling. A second way in which trial measures may differ is the weight that is assigned to each dimension and its indicators. One trial measure, for example, can assign equal weights to each dimension, reflecting the fact that they're all considered to be equally important, whereas another one may assign a weight to education that is twice the weight that is assigned to the health dimension, reflecting the fact that education has a greater relative importance compared to health. A third way in which trial measures may differ is the poverty cutoff. One trial measure may define a person as being multidimensionally poor if they face a number of weighted deprivations that is equivalent to one dimension or more, whereas another one can consider two dimensions or more. In essence, you can have a large number of candidate measures, but it is much preferable to have a small set of candidate measures that are meaningful, in the sense that they can be mapped out to real policy priorities. One measure, for instance, can be designed to closely map the SDGs, whereas another measure can actually be designed to map very closely the National Development Plan. In the end, if they are conceived as potential measures of the national NPI, then they need to have a meaning and they need to be useful for national policy priorities. Once a small set of selected candidate measures has been defined, before accepting one candidate measure as a valid one, we need to make sure that it is robust. We want the key messages and policy conclusions that it offers to be stable. This is important, because if a measure is not robust, then it shouldn't be a candidate measure in the first place. Technical teams have to be the filters between non-robust measures and policymakers. There are many ways of assessing robustness, and they are related to the purpose of the measure. National NPIs are normally designed to capture subnational differences, for example, between urban and rural areas, or between provinces or states. Some countries use that information for budgeting. In those cases, we don't want the poverty orderings by state, province, or area to depend on the decisions that we're making. One way of making sure that that's the case is by performing a rank correlation analysis. This analysis is a simple and transparent way of assessing robustness. Another one is to take into account the fact that virtually all national NPIs are computed using survey data which have sampling error. This matters when we want to compare poverty estimates between regions or between provinces or states. Pairwise comparisons use that information because they rely on statistical tests. Importantly, one may use robustness analyses to be sure of the stability of a measure to an array of possible alternatives, not necessarily to all the alternatives that one can imagine, because they are basically uncountable. For instance, one often comes across disagreement when it comes to setting weights. Some people may have reason to defend that education should be more important than health, for example. Others can actually find an argument for the opposite, whereas others may advocate an equal importance for both of them. If a robustness analysis proves that the subnational orderings in terms of provinces, states, or regions is independent of the decision that we make, then we can objectively settle a discussion that otherwise would be very cumbersome. Interestingly, when good data and indicators are combined in an adequate way, robustness is actually very common in practice. Another key message of the lesson is related to the next step after having identified the candidate measures that are robust. Then one has to analyze them, and the policymaker will make the decision as to which one of them is going to become the structure of the national MPI. One way of conducting this analysis is to make use of two very powerful axiomatic properties of the Alcarin-Foster method. The first is subnational disaggregation, by which one can compute the level of the MPI and the level of incidence and intensity of multidimensional poverty for different regions or provinces within the country, as well as different population subgroups, for example, different age cohorts. The second is a decomposition of the aggregate measure to determine the contribution of each indicator and dimension to multidimensional poverty as defined by each candidate measure. It is important to stress that at this point, emphasis should not be on the results themselves, because they are preliminary. Rather, one should focus on the coherence of the structure and whether it enables it to be a useful and relevant tool to track poverty and to design policy actions to end it, as well as to foster coordination between ministries. Finally, it is very important to stress that every single element in the national MPI is important. Among them, however, the poverty cutoff has always been the object of considerable attention, and it does have a particular relevance. It separates the poor population from the non-poor population. It therefore needs to have two characteristics. It needs to be legitimate, in the sense that it effectively allows to find people who identify themselves as poor. A good measure can never overlook people who truly deserve policy priority. It also has to be transparent and easy to communicate to a wide audience. If the population or the international community do not understand how people in a country are identified as being multidimensionally poor, then that statistic simply does not enjoy credibility. For this, it is always wise to think about the communicational aspects of the selection of the poverty cutoff. They need to be combined with the technical rigor that comes along with the robustness analysis. As an example, in a national MPI that has four dimensions, it is easy to understand and to communicate a poverty cutoff of 25%, because it very transparently reflects the fact that somebody is identified as being poor if they are deprived in a number of weighted deprivations that is equivalent to one dimension or more. In that case, a poverty cutoff of 33% is not easy to communicate, and it's much less easy to understand. With this in mind, it is now time to precisely review some communicational aspects of the process of developing the national MPI. We will now turn to the presentation of some concrete examples of how countries present the processes that led to the national MPI, as well as their results.